The last memory management thing that I want to go over actually touches on the virtual size that Nate mentioned in the critical path. All right, so remember when Nate was showing us PS, he said, here's your virtual size and your resident size. The resident size is actual RAM is being, or virtual memory is being used by this application. Actually, I take that back. It's how much real system memory is used by the application. It doesn't include anything that's been swapped out. The V size is the address space allocated to this process. Often the case, the processes will ask for a pile of memory, but not immediately use it all. And so what the kernel does is it just kind of like creates a process address space for memory. It says, oh, you asked for a gig of RAM. Here's an address space with a gig worth of RAM memory addresses in it. And then the application starts putting things in those addresses, which then the kernel uses a subroutine to actually map that to system memory. Process memory is always kind of separate and managed by the process, but that's in a separate address space that the kernel allocates to each process. We can look at that process memory using PMAP. Actually, I installed Apache so we could use it to look at its process memory. So if I do a PMAP of process 2525, this is actually telling me the process address space being used by this Apache process. And it gives the starting memory address and the process memory address space, the amount of memory, and what it's being used for, and also like what it can be used for. And so I mentioned earlier about anonymous pages or like a piece of data used for internal process data storage. You could see here that this Apache daemon has some anonymous memory used. It's taken some process-specific data and shoved it into this section of memory. And then we see this lib stuff. Nate, I know you know what these lib things are.
That'd be shared libraries brought in from the system, right?
Yeah. And the purpose
which also take up memory.
Yes. But does every process need to have their memory taken up with these shared libraries?
No, because they are shared libraries. And the kernel will intelligently allow processes to read the libraries that are in memory if they're already in memory.
But a individual process doesn't know that somebody else has already loaded that shared memory into RAM. So what happens is the shared library gets loaded by someone who requested it and put into system memory. It's assigned to that process's memory. If another process starts up and wants the same shared object library, it will also request it from the kernel and it will go into the process memory for that process as well. But in system memory, there's really only one copy stored. So when it's asked for by the process, we'll kind of determine where in its memory address space it lives. There's probably only one copy of this library actually resident in system memory. This is another reason why the virtual size for a process and the resident size for a process are often very different. Because maybe it asked for a bunch of shared object libraries that were loaded into system RAM, but other people had already loaded them. And so it doesn't count against this process's resident memory size, right? Counts against somebody else on the system's resident memory size. But we can see if I look at another HTTPD process, this one has more anonymous memory, but then it gets down into the same shared object libraries. Two HTTPD daemons need the same shared object libraries for their normal stuff. That's an example of where like this process gets loaded, but that memory doesn't count against its against its virtual size. If I go back to the process listing, notice that some of them, like this guy, he doesn't have a really large amount of resident memory. These are more consistent, probably because they have more anonymous pages shoved into their memory address space. They ask for an address space of, it looks like about each, but they're only using 15 megs of that space. So we told the process, yes, you can have a gig. Here's your addresses for a gig of memory. And then as it started to populate it with data, it's really only using 15 megabytes of that space. which brings me to my next virtual memory tunable. By default, thanks to this value being zero, our kernel overcommits memory, right? Because if processes all are like, I need a gig, but I'm only going to use 15 meg, why would we stop accepting memory requests when we know there's this ton of unused system memory? Because even though people asked for it, they're not using it.
Right.
And so overcommit memory set to zero says I want to overcommit, and actually uses a kernel algorithm for figuring out, based on the amount of free space that's left and what people are using, how much should I overcommit to? So it's kind of a dynamic heuristic algorithm for determining how much your system can actually overcommit to. If you actually went through like all the processes on your system and added up their address space sizes, it would be way bigger than the actual virtual memory available on the machine.
Right.
Overcommit. So you could change your overcommitment policy, set this to a one, which says, I don't want to overcommit unless I do, in which case there's a second tunable called overcommit ratio, which is like, I will overcommit up to 25% over virtual memory, right? So you can set a ratio of how much you're willing to overcommit to. And then you can set it to two, which means always overcommit. There is no memory allocation request too large for us to say yes to. We'll always say yes. And that's probably not what you want, because at some point you may need to say no if you've got a lot of things in memory and your system memory is being used.
What could go wrong, Scott? I mean, really, just all the, give out memory like free candy.
Exactly. Which is why we default to zero, which is like, use your best estimate, figure out what the machine's doing and kind of like manage it on its own rather than always saying yes.
Use memory we don't have, but be careful.
Right. So I showed you a new utility called PMAP, your process map. It goes through and actually like shows you what the memory address space for a process looks like. If we actually went over to PROC 2526, what that's actually showing us is like, I think it's this. No, it's one of these others.
Maps.
Yeah, I think you're right. It's maps. But this is kind of the same thing, right? Except these blanks are non-pages, but showing you these are all memory addresses allocated to the machine and what's stored in them. This one has a lot of anonymous memory already allocated to it. And then you get down to like the shared object libraries and stuff. So PMAP gives you a more human-friendly way of reading that data.